PNG has been a standard image format for basically as long as I can remember, with the spec being announced in 1994 and then being formalized in 1996, then released as RFC 2083 in March of 1997, PNG Portable Network Graphic Specification version 1.0, a very exciting name. But this is what you get in the RFC space. Then from there, we had further releases like 1.1 in 1998 and 1.2 in 1999, with it being reformatted for the W3C release in 2003 and the ISO release in 2004. And that was basically the end of it. And those weren't substantial changes. They were basically just reformatting and shoring up a couple of areas where things were missed. It had been about 21 years since we'd seen any real changes made to the PNG spec. That's not to say there hasn't been tons of development work in the PNG space, whether that be displaying them, working with PNGs, and then exporting them into a new PNG file, but the specification itself, that's been pretty rock solid, and this is a good sign of a spec that was done right at the start. Something where, yes, there might be areas that it could be improved upon, but it's a rock-solid choice. That is, until a few days back, where a new version of the specification was actually released. After 2 decades, a refresh to the PNG spec with some really massive additions, currently available on the W3C website, Portable Network Graphics PNG Specification 3rd Edition. Now, of course, most of it is going to be exactly the same as early specs because it's still PNG. This is not some revolutionary new format called a PNG that has nothing to do with PNG. It's still a PNG. But what it's basically doing is taking some extensions that have been worked on separately for quite a while and then formalizing them as official parts of PNG. And changing everything anyway just wouldn't work because you wouldn't know what sort of PNG you're dealing with. Is this an old PNG? Is this a new PNG? Massive breaking changes with the same name is always going to be a support nightmare. It makes way more sense to do that as its own new unique thing. That's not what this is though. So here we have a write-up explaining some of the key takeaways from this new version. This is by Chris Bloom, one of the editors on the specification. Firstly, proper HDR support, future-proof too. I'm sure whenever people try to make things future-proof, they never miss something and end up not actually future-proofing it. Hopefully this goes well, and hopefully 15 years from now there's not some different case people think of where it wasn't actually as future-proof as they thought. Figure 1 shows the colors our eyes can see. The smaller inner triangle represents the color space of most images. The larger outer triangle represents the colors that are typical with a high dynamic range HDR image. Now, this video is obviously rendered in SDR, standard dynamic range, and you probably are on an SDR display anyway. So, this is gonna look like the same green from here to here. If you happen to have an HDR display and assuming this image is rendered correctly, go to the website and let me know if it looks different, because I don't have, actually I do have one as my Steam Deck, but I'm not going to plug my Steam Deck in or turn it on to look at this one image. But it still serves the purpose of demonstrating that more colors are shown in HDR. That's the whole point of HDR. This new HDR support only uses 4 bytes plus the usual PNG chunk overhead. Chris Lilly, one of PNG's original co-authors and the current technical director contributing to the new PNG work, wrote an excellent article explaining how this works. Now this gets very deep into how colors actually function, and I'll leave a lot of this to you guys, and I'll leave a lot of this to Chris explaining it, because there is no way I can possibly explain it better than somebody who literally is involved in making the PNG spec. But let's take a look anyway. So the PNG 3rd edition adds coding independent code points for color space identification. What is CICP? Why should you care? And should you be using it? And if so, how? So what is color? It is an objective measured value describing the human visual perception of some object that is emitting light, or for physical objects, is illuminated by some light and reflecting some of that light to our eye. This measurement consists of 3 numbers, X, Y, and Z. Two objects that have identical X, Y, and Z values will look exactly the same to a normal human observer. This is the start of the post getting it very technical. The first one here links to an explanation on colorblindness and male and females perceiving color in slightly different ways. And then there is the issue of objects that emit light, something, something, color, wave, nonsense. Not important to the main point here. If you want to go dig deep into technical stuff, I'll leave this link down below. Because working with three-dimensional data is hard, it is common to convert XYZ values into chromaticity values X and Y, where X equals X divided by X plus Y plus Z, and Y equals Y divided by X plus Y plus Z. Two objects with the same chromaticity values will look the same color, but one may be brighter or darker than the other. To reproduce a given color on a particular screen, we need to know the chromaticities of the red, green, and blue primaries, and also the exact mix of the white that results when those three are mixed together in equal proportions. We also need to know the relationship between the numbers we send to a screen and the amount of light generated. This is typically not a linear relationship. For example, if a monitor takes values from 0 to 255 and we send a number in the middle, 127, we would typically only get 21% of the full amount of light, not 50%. This is called the transfer function. Taken together, the primary chromaticities and the white point define the gamut or range of colors that a given screen can produce. If we also know the transfer function, then for any color that is in gamut, we can calculate the red, green, and blue values needed to display that color. In other words, we have defined a color space. Now, the CICP specification allows labeling of what color space is used for a given image. It doesn't say how to handle that color space because it is just saying which of the small number of industry standard color spaces being used, the implementation is expected to handle all of them. Now, as I said, this gets very deep into how all of the math behind this works, so I will leave the rest of that for you guys linked in the description down below. Let's move on with the rest of PNG. Finally recognizes APNGs. Animated PNGs were proposed by Mozilla quite some time ago. That is certainly a way to use that phrase. Initial release, August 27th, 2004, almost 21 years ago as of next month. So yeah, I would say it was proposed quite some time ago. Support was added to Firefox, but other programs hesitated to adopt them. Today, animated PNGs are widely supported. It is time for the spec to reflect reality. I have literally never seen an APNG outside of this demo of an APNG. I don't... Can you make them in GIMP? I actually have literally no idea. If somebody knows, please let me know. And officially supports EXIF data, also known as that thing you should probably turn off on your phone unless you want people to know where you are when you take a picture. EXIF stores additional information such as copyright and even camera lens and GPS location of a photograph. I know that this is a thing that people like, and it's a great thing for photographers, all this sort of stuff. It's like very useful for like categorizing your photos. And it probably should have been supported, but again, just make sure you don't include the GPS location of your pictures, especially if you're taking them at your house. And some general tidying up, fixing errata, clarifications, etc. It has been a bit of a while since there's been a proper update to the spec, so this probably needed to happen as well, but is not a substantial change. Now, many companies and many programs have already adopted these changes. The new spec is already supported in Chrome, Safari, Firefox, iOS, macOS, Photoshop, DaVinci Resolve, Avid, Media, Composer, and a bunch of others as well. Now, what happens from henceforth? I know you all immediately wondered, better compression. This is a serious problem that PNG has. It is nice to have high quality images, but on the web, you kind of want to have high quality images and bring the file sizes down just a little bit because JPEG's not great. You know, we've all seen the crunchy JPEG memes, haha, you recompress the JPEG 1,000 times. Not a problem with PNG, but also, they're quite large. And we're already working on that, and parallel encoding slash decoding too. Just like with this update, we want to make sure we do it right, so it should be sometime within the next 10 years. We expect the next PNG update, 4th edition, to be short. It will improve HDR and standard dynamic range interoperability. While we work on that, we'll be researching compression updates for PNG 5th edition. So probably sometime, I would say by 2050, we should be in a good position with PNG. Whilst there are new formats that people have been pushing, PNG is not going anywhere. It is a staple of the web, and improvements to it are honestly just a good thing. Dealing with the compression problems, probably going to be a pretty big improvement there. But what do you think? Do you use PNGs? Yeah, there we go. There's my most generic comment possible. Do you use PNGs? Feed the algorithm. I want to see 1,000 people write yes in my comment section. Anyway, if you liked the video, go like the video. If you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, silly Berapay, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and honestly, sometimes I have no idea what I'm doing with the yep, exactly. What I have no... We're done. What is this?